Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Not Light, But Fire, How to Lead Meaningful Race Conversations in the Classroom, by Matthew R. Kay, narrated by David Sadzin. In loving memory of Cheryl Jones Kay, my mother, a 36-year teaching veteran, and the reason I do what I do, I've decided to keep you. Acknowledgements. I'd like to thank my wife, Kate, for providing honest, insightful, and comprehensive feedback on every draft of this book. My father, Rosamond, for the decades of mind-sharpening debate that model the discourse I want for my students. And my aunt, Connie, for her unconditional love and support. Thanks to my principal and great friend, Chris Lehman, for all the professional opportunities that led to the writing of this book. I will always be grateful to my editor, Tori, for her patience, expertise, and encouragement. Finally, thank you, Dia. You were a perfect gift, just in time. Daddy loves you. Introduction. Not Light, But Fire. The Case for Meaningful Conversations. Talk is cheap. We have built a mountain of cliches to say as much, and a canon of stories to indict the boastful rabbits and loose lips among us. History praises Lincoln for his brevity at Gettysburg, while it forgets Edward Everett's two-hour speech that preceded it. Shakespeare made sure that Hamlet punished Polonius's sermonizing with an ignoble death while hiding. And lest the bard's point go unmade, the wavering prince meets his own end only after letting his righteous revenge dissolve into words, words, words. The most garrulous among us are dismissed as weak-willed. Many hate a windbag, most fear the silver-tongued. Knowing that those who talk long often talk wrong, we have developed a uniquely American succinctness. We expect to be sold ideas in the time it takes to ride an elevator, and to be able to judge their merits just as quickly. Yet, moments of racial tension scratch from us a great tolerance for empty talk. There is a certain formula a racial story can reach, some unknown combination of timing, rarity, and the notoriety of those involved, that draws analysts to gravely suggest that we need to talk about race. And then we do. A lot. With little regard for substance or coherence, we find our airwaves filled with empty rhetoric and thoughtless repetition. Consider, for example, the following race conversation from our nation's not-too-distant history. In March of 2008, ABC News unearthed some of the Reverend Jeremiah Wright's sermons, highlighting lines like, "The government gives them the drugs, builds bigger prisons, passes a three-strike law, and then wants us to sing God Bless America." No, 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 not God bless America, God damn America. That's in the Bible, for killing innocent people. God damn America for treating us citizens as less than human. And this excerpt, responding to 9/11, that borrows from Malcolm X's comments after the Kennedy assassination. "We have supported state terrorism against the Palestinians and black South Africans, and now we are indignant, because the stuff that we have done overseas is now brought right back into our own front yard. America's chickens are coming home to roost." After trying in vain to quell the controversy about his pastor, then-Senator Obama was forced to deliver his celebrated More Perfect Union speech, where he acknowledged that Wright had used incendiary language to express views that had the potential to not only widen the racial divide, but views that denigrate the greatness and the goodness of our nation. Later, Obama argued that we have a choice in this country. We can accept a politics that breeds division and conflict and cynicism. We can tackle race only as spectacle, as we did in the O.J. trial, or in the wake of tragedy, as we did in the aftermath of Katrina, or as fodder for the nightly news. We can play Reverend Wright's sermons on every channel, every day, and talk about them from now until the election, and make the only question in this campaign whether or not the American people think that I somehow believe or sympathize with his most offensive words. Or, he then pivoted to a plea for post-racial populism, challenging Americans to talk about crumbling schools, jobs, and health care. The speech was received well enough to inspire T. Deneen Sharpley Whiting to gather a collection of scholarly essays written about it into a book titled The Speech, Race and Barack Obama's A More Perfect Union. Eminent scholars such as Michael Eric Dyson and Ta-Nehisi Coates contributed. But, considering this race issue settled, the public conversation had already moved on. The issue flared back up, however, soon after our country's first black president was elected, when Harvard professor Henry Louis Gates was arrested in front of his home in Cambridge, Massachusetts. 6 days later, President Obama claimed that the arresting officer had acted stupidly, and the call for conversation went out again. Many of us remember the resulting beer summit, where the involved parties talked reconciliation near the White House Rose Garden. More recently, we have collectively held forth on the Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown, and Eric Garner decisions, riots in Baltimore, shootings in Charleston, and the burning of black churches. As supremacists march, we talk. As Confederate statues come down, we talk. We tweet, we post, we meme, we chat. Our news networks cram 8 analysts into 8 tiny boxes, then pit them in a moderated struggle to be the most quotable. It's not a new habit. We have always appreciated a chance to bloviate about race. In 1852, Frederick Douglass was invited to speak at Corinthian Hall by the Rochester Ladies Anti-Slavery Association. He'd been asked to deliver an address celebrating the 4th of July, an odd request for a man who had to steal his own freedom. Midway through his speech, he famously skewered America's preoccupation with meaningless race conversation. Specifically, Douglass critiqued our national eagerness to make theater out of the obvious, while leaving tough conversations for future generations. Douglass, along with many abolitionists, had often been chided for the honesty and directness of his race discourse. He was told that, instead of offering fiery rebukes, he should spend more time shedding light on the country's race problem. That afternoon in Rochester, an exasperated Douglass finally responded, "On what branch of the subject do the people of this country need light?" He then offered up his frustrations. "Must I undertake to prove that the slave is a man? That point is conceded already. Nobody doubts it. The slaveholders themselves acknowledge it in the enactment of laws for their government. It is admitted in the fact that Southern statute books are covered with enactments forbidding, under severe fines and penalties, the teaching of the slave to read or to write. When you can point to any such laws in reference to the beasts of the field, then I may consent to argue the manhood of the slave. When the dogs in your streets, when the fowls of the air, when the cattle on your hills, when the fish of the sea and the reptiles that crawl shall be unable to distinguish the slave from a brute, then will I argue with you that the slave is a man. And would you have me argue that man is entitled to liberty, that he is the rightful owner of his own body? You have already declared it. There is not a man beneath the canopy of heaven that does not know that slavery is wrong for him." Then, soon after, he offered his audience a challenge. "It is not light that is needed, but fire." Douglass knew what many are noticing now, that we never seem to graduate to the next conversation, the hard one, that we hide our stasis beneath puffed-up punditry and circular debate. He called for us to infuse our conversations with fire, to seek out and value historical context, to be driven by authentic inquiry, and above all, to be honest, both with ourselves and with those with whom we share a racial dialogue. Just as fire rarely passes through an environment without acting upon it, so too should our world be impacted by our students' race conversations. This is a book for educators who want to answer Douglass's challenge. Teachers who wish to tackle race conversations with more than a light show, who want something to be different after they and their students have wrestled with the great ideas. This book does not seek to prove what has already been proven, that all students are capable of learning, that many of our students of color face considerable and purposeful inequity, that diversity is a beautiful opportunity for any teacher. It will not linger in debates about the value of student voice. It will acknowledge as fact that most educators are people of goodwill, that most of us respect the enormity of the task before us. Its directness will honor the time that educators commit to it. Each chapter grounds itself in a dialogic tradition that understands that great learning happens when both teachers and students explore the limits of their own understanding through rigorous discussion. We have long known that students, given the opportunity to speak and listen, take more responsibility for their interpretations, retain these interpretations longer, and develop agility of mind. Perhaps most importantly, dialogic pedagogy disrupts the traditional classroom power dynamic, positioning school as a place where students have an equal share in their education. Students are not empowered. Rather, they are shown that their inherent power has been recognized, and that it matters. Well-crafted discussions build confidence, and confidence is sacred currency to students and teachers alike. This is an action book with a movement mission. It will live in the how of powerful race conversations, acknowledging that the why has already been addressed. It is for teachers who wish to help students develop healthy habits of both mind and discourse that will serve them for the rest of their lives. It is hard for a student to unlearn empathy, to forget discernment, to dismiss the importance of solid evidence once they've grown used to demanding it. This book acknowledges that if we are training the next generation of teachers, entertainers, lawyers, and politicians, if we are molding thoughtful citizens, wise counselors, and people of righteous passion, then our classrooms must be deliberate in their approach to conversations about race. The next generation needs to be far better at this stuff than we have been. They are coming of age in a world of artfully disguised injustices, most of which will stay both invisible and vicious if people never learn how to meaningfully discuss them. Owning our justifiable fear. During one of my graduate classes at the University of Pennsylvania, we discussed how to lead meaningful conversations about race. Our professor had pulled quotes from our responses to an online prompt, then hung them on chart paper around the classroom. We were asked to walk around, commenting on each paper with sticky notes. Itching for a fight in the way of the vaguely bored, I deliberately tried to stir up trouble with comments that seemed either superficial or untested. One classmate claimed, with undue confidence, that most minority students were afraid to talk about race, then asked how teachers might manage this fear. To that, I scribbled, "They are afraid? Says who?" This narrative of minority students afraid to discuss race didn't hold up against an avalanche of anecdotal evidence that seemed to prove otherwise. I knew my experiences were no more all-encompassing than any other teacher's, but my minority students discussed race openly and vigorously in most of their social spaces. Their social media lit up with observations every time some racial incident hit the news. I saw nothing that would indicate timidity on the topic. Yet, in progressive education circles, we seem determined to make these same students more comfortable discussing race. Where on earth did that idea come from? I looked around a graduate classroom of overwhelmingly white, middle and upper class, well-intentioned future teachers. And I thought to myself, have you asked them if they are afraid to talk about race? I know that if they had asked me when I was in high school, I would have answered that race talk is oxygen to Black folks, breathed into our jokes, our social norms, our storytelling at family gatherings. I'd tell them how we identify strangers by race before other physical descriptions. If I was close to them, I'd add that whiteness, especially, occupies a special, complicated place in our dialogue. Black folks tease it in its absence, talk about it behind its back. I'd tell them that, no, teenage me was not afraid to discuss race. I'd ask if these teachers were projecting their own fears onto me. If they were, what were they afraid of? Messing up? Saying the wrong things? Mishandling controversy? Letting their own bias show? All of the above? And perhaps with good reason. Cautionary Tales. Hollywood has spent decades telling teachers to ignore these fears and boldly jolt students into engagement. In the movie Stand and Deliver, for example, teacher Jaime Escalante teases the gang members in his class by saying, "Tough guys don't do math. Tough guys deep fry chicken for a living. You want a wing or a leg?" In Dangerous Minds, Luann Johnson tells her students that nobody is forcing you to be here. You can stay or you can leave. You either don't graduate or you have to put up with me. It may not be a choice you like, but it is a choice. In the 2007 movie Freedom Riders, teacher Aaron Gruel points out the similarity between a drawing found on a student's desk and the racial caricatures central to Nazi propaganda. In the midst of the ensuing argument, she tells a boy, "You know what's going to happen when you die? You're going to rot in the ground, and people are going to go on living, and they're going to forget all about you. And when you rot, do you think it's going to matter whether you were an original gangster? You're dead, and nobody is going to want to remember you because all you left behind in this world is this." She holds up the caricature. All three speeches inspire immediate student breakthroughs. Escalante's tough guy solves a math problem. Johnson's students start thoughtfully interpreting Bob Dylan lyrics, while Gruel's shyly ask her to explain the Holocaust. Shocking students, of course, requires teachers to eschew students' expectations. In all three of these movies, teachers offered brutal directness when their students, presumably, expected meekness. Hollywood's seamless execution of such techniques and the prompt rewards that followed caused a generation of teachers to attempt their own racial shock and awe campaigns, only to find out that it was nowhere near as easy or prudent. It's safe to assume that this teacher was not a Nazi and that her intentions were neither to encourage anti-Semitism nor to recruit future skinheads. I suspect that she had opposite intentions, to have her students struggle with the absurdity of hateful thought systems in what would seem to be a key step to dismantling them. And she likely sought to connect her students' understanding of the rhetorical devices, logos, pathos, and ethos to each technique's real-world exploitation in propaganda. What student would prefer arguing that oranges are the best fruit when they could instead engage Nazism? Yet she faced immediate resistance. One-third of the students in the class refused to write the essay. Then, in a teacher's nightmare, an irate parent fed her assignment to the local news, which quickly spread to the Associated Press, which led to national reports on CBS and CNN and articles in the Washington Post and New York Times. While none of these reports identified the teacher, all quoted Albany's superintendent, Marguerite Vanden Weingard's response. The assignment to her was completely unacceptable. She asked, "How could you ask a student to justify prejudice leading to genocide? It's an illogical leap. It doesn't make any sense." She allowed that the teacher probably didn't intend to cause any insensitivities to our families of Jewish faith. Still, the teacher would be suspended, and the superintendent would enter into conversations with the Anti-Defamation League about future sensitivity training for her staff. Many of us would have more thoughtfully considered this assignment, but there are many ways that discussing race can get us flayed on the news. In 2014, for example, a teacher in Redmond, Washington, was working through a unit on the Industrial Revolution and found her students having trouble understanding the cotton gin. So she brought in cotton plants and asked her seventh graders to pull the cotton from the plant and separate the seeds. The irate mother of one black student gave her daughter permission to not do the assignment. The teacher, in a tough love move that seems plucked from the aforementioned hero-teacher movies, gave her a failing grade. This student's mother took the story to the local media, which ran a segment that was picked up by the Huffington Post. In it, she says, "My daughter is African-American, and for her to pick cotton when our grandparents were raised on a plantation to pick cotton, it's just not okay. Not okay at all." When asked for comment, the Lake Washington School District issued a written statement to remind critics that the lesson was about the impact that the invention of the cotton gin had on the Industrial Revolution. Lake Washington, unlike Albany, apparently supported their teacher's idea, if not its execution. Still, with all of the fuss, it is not hard to imagine this teacher deciding that engaging race this sensorially is not worth the headache. These incidents are unique only in their publicity. Every time that I facilitate a professional development workshop on how to lead meaningful race conversations, I ask if participants have similar horror stories. The question is met with a forest of hands. Some recall old episodes from their student years. Parents describe horrendous incidents from their children's classes. Colleagues share blunders that they've heard through their school's grapevine. Occasionally, brave teachers expose their own mistakes. Each time, it's painfully clear that every teacher's missteps during race conversations are magnified regardless of their intentions. The penalty for misspeaking, improper planning, or a lack of foresight can be the total loss of a teacher's moral authority. And once lost, students' respect can seem impossible to recover. No wonder my Penn classmates spoke about the prospect of race discussions with a tremble in their voices. No teacher wants to be the villain in someone else's horror story or the fool in a dark comedy. But we can't settle our own anxieties by passing them on to our students. If they are fearful, it is not a myopic fear. It is a fear just as layered as our own, ranging from mild nervousness over using the correct racial labels to those reflected in a Facebook message sent to me by a former student on the night of the Trayvon Martin decision that said, "I'm afraid of how bloody tonight might be." Many realize the limits of a social media diet of out-of-context news clips and misleading memes. Many recognize that Facebook is only a place for declarations, its comment threads mostly inhospitable to probing questions. They recognize that Twitter's very nature values brevity over layered inquiry. They have a desire to wrestle with hard ideas, but instead find themselves needing to speak fast and listen hurriedly. They want the conversation to, paradoxically for such a rapid age, slow down. If anything, I propose that we teachers are most afraid of this eagerness. In contrast to their engagement with a great many of our discussion topics, many of our students actually hold passionate opinions about race. These opinions are unpredictable, and they accompany questions that seem far outside our training. And students actually care if we get it right. This added pressure leads too many of us to think that only certain personality types, the magic teachers among us, are equipped to lead meaningful race conversations. But it's not magic. Allow me to excoriate one last hero-teacher movie. In The Dead Poets Society, fiery Mr. Keating asks his students to read the preface to their class textbook. There, Mr. J. Evans Pritchard, Ph.D., has written a guide to understanding poetry, a precise metric for measuring a poem's greatness, which Keating sketches derisively on the chalkboard. Keating then whispers, excrement. That's what I think of Mr. J. Evans Pritchard. We're not laying pipe, we're talking about poetry. Now I want you to rip out that page. Fired up by his students' minute-long assault on their textbooks, Keating delivers the movie's iconic speech, "This is a battle, a war, and the casualties may be your hearts and souls. In my class, you will learn to think for yourselves again." Keating's diatribe implies that objective measurement is both soulless and a ridiculous way to ascertain the value of a poem or the effectiveness of a teacher. Great teachers are instead born with immeasurable, unteachable stuff. This presumption leads many to believe that powerful classroom conversations require a Mr. Keating, iconoclastic, charismatic, blessed with a preternatural interpersonal intelligence. Teachers who do not readily identify as one of these types, those of us who are more quiet, less combative, more deliberative, begin to consider our conversational game to be fixed. We are either cool enough to hold great conversations or we aren't. And no amount of professional development can stretch the limits of our intuition. But this is too simple. First, such a stance implies that Keating types' conversational successes are due to intuition, not hard work. It ignores hours spent picking the best texts, designing the best prompts, researching the best structures, practicing the best activities, reflecting and building up both victories and failures. The more a teacher's work is ignored, the easier it is for him to ease up on the work, start slipping, and have no idea what went wrong. Furthermore, it demoralizes colleagues who yearn for their colleagues' conversational successes. This often inspires jealousies, which eventually dissolve the important connective tissue between classrooms. It's hard to collaborate through closed doors. Most importantly, such a stance stymies teacher development. We rarely work on attributes that we believe to be fixed. We invest hundreds on gym memberships because we consider our waistlines alterable. We listen to Rosetta Stone lessons because we know our brains have room for new words. The moment our deficiencies become immutable, our efforts to improve begin to wane. Some among us do have innate conversational strengths. Yet, teachers who come to the discourse naturally can't be the only people with enough confidence to broach hard classroom discussions. Morale must be developed through a purposeful, logic-driven, measurable method. A reliable process that can be both applied and reflected on without magical thinking. The chapters of Part 1 propose developing an ecosystem that can reliably support effective classroom race discussions. The first chapter describes quality relationship building, both horizontally among students and vertically with their teachers. In the second, teachers will learn which interpersonal skills are most beneficial to holding productive race conversations and how to develop them. Chapter 3 describes the curriculum and conversational structures that are most important to sustaining the rigor, empathy, and focus that these important conversations deserve. While listening to the final chapter of this section, teachers will learn how to infuse their conversations with clearly communicated purpose, so that students will not only know what's at stake, but fully understand their locus of control. Each of the chapters of Part 2 will take a closer look at a different, specific meaningful race conversation that I've held with my students. Most of these conversations are composites, drawing statements and exchanges from over a decade of classroom discourse. The last will be an example of what this book calls a pop-up conversation, one made necessary by students' concerns about current events. While I offer concrete examples throughout the book for how teachers might practice the new habits and skills described with peers before students, the epilogue proposes an approach to professional development that an entire department could adopt so everyone can grow these skills and confidence to not only face but embrace meaningful race conversations together. With earnest humility in the face of the heavy lift before us, let us begin. Part 1. The Ecosystem. Successful race conversations depend on a very specific ecosystem. As teachers, our biggest mistake is undervaluing any of the many elements that might, on their surface, seem inconsequential, but that turn out to be vital for our discourse's survival. Without healthy classroom relationships and sound conversational structures, race conversations cannot thrive. Without honest interpersonal skill development, teachers' successes will depend more on natural personality traits, which are more unpredictable than we like to think. Finally, without clear methods of establishing purpose, students will rarely decide to invest enough mental, spiritual, and emotional energy to move any race conversation from light to fire. Chapter 1. Demystifying the Safe Space. The first, and ultimately most important, magical concept to be demystified is the safe space. Among progressive educators, no goal is more holy. In each classroom, students are to feel comfortable enough with their various identities to be honest, open, and vulnerable. Conveniently alliterative, the term safe space captures our best dreams of what classrooms can be. Havens, calm harbors, shelter from our students' stormy home lives, neighborhood violence, or school drama. The dream is so powerful that naming it has become a staple of our introductory spiel. My name is Mr. K, and I want you to consider this classroom a safe space. This assertion is offered with a magician's, "Voila, I have said it, therefore it is so." And with these magic words, bullies are tamed and introverts peek from their shells. We are suddenly ready to lead conversations about sensitive topics because our students are magically now eager to take risks. If, over the course of the year, they forget our first day pronouncement, we eagerly remind them, "Remember, everyone, this is a safe space." After this, students who undermine such spaces are viewed as troublemakers, and to mete out appropriate discipline, we pull from our bag a behavior modification tactics. Meanwhile, familiar classroom hierarchies and interactions remain stubbornly visible. Outspoken kids still dominate conversation, and students remain disagreeable when they disagree. This, of course, frustrates us. Why won't students share in our utopian vision? Did they not hear us? They did. However, for most students, a teacher's safe space designation doesn't mean much. Definitions of safety are surprisingly varied. For some teachers, the term is used in its most literal sense. This is safe space. Here we don't fight each other. This makes great sense in a school in which wayward students roam the halls looking for open classroom doors to burst into and disrupt lessons, or where neighborhood kids regularly wait at the nearest subway stop looking to jump the most vulnerable. When teachers in these environments promise a safe space, they might simply want their students operating a step higher on Maslow's hierarchy of needs, assured that each class period won't end in a bloody nose. Kids might breathe easier for an hour or so. In less harrowing environments, however, teachers use the term to describe a sense of order. This is a safe space so everyone can focus on their work. Here, the students are safe from both distractions and surprises. Eighth graders often describe this particular safety when interviewing for a spot at my school, Science Leadership Academy, SLA. Asked to describe their ideal learning environment, more than a few answer, a place where all the students are sitting down and they are quiet while the teacher is speaking. Nobody is shouting out. When the teacher tells them to do something, they do it. Nobody is acting up. This classic vision shows up everywhere, from no excuses charters to elite magnets to public, private, and parochial schools, large and small. Less often, and more controversially, teachers use the term to reference ideological safety. This is a safe space, so your ideological comfort is valued. This definition has been red meat in political conversations among conservatives and liberals alike, especially when it comes to college classrooms. The right rails against the encroachment of political correctness, which is deviously softening a generation of students, while the left caricatures its opponents as simple-minded zealots incapable of properly nurturing diverse student populations. The tension between these views especially affects conversations about race, leaving teachers to define where on the ideological comfort spectrum they'd like their classroom conversations to fall. This can be especially frustrating for students, who might find standards in their English class drastically different from those in their history class. Not to mention the yearly vertical transitions, grade to grade, school to school, that bring waves of disparate definitions of safety mixed in with teachers who don't bother making the claim in the first place. It's not just that students must decipher what a teacher means when they claim safe space. They must also shoulder an unannounced burden, responsibility over their classmates. Schooling is an individual exercise. Most of its incentives, from kindergarten through graduate school, are individualized. For example, glossy stickers, grades, scholarships, internships, jobs. Collaboration is generally the least valued and most haphazardly executed aspect of teachers' pedagogy, and some entire schools are being built around individualization and specialization. When we then ask students to, in effect, be their brother's keeper, many understandably have no idea what comes next. And this is where we, as teachers, must have more to offer than a day one abracadabra. In order to nurture hard conversations about race, first we must commit to building conversational safe spaces, not merely declaring them. The foundation of such spaces is listening. When facilitating professional development sessions, I often ask teachers to describe a moment when they felt truly listened to. How did they know that the listening was authentic? Eye contact, patience, engagement, focus. How did that moment make them feel? Valued, important, safe. I share with these colleagues my own listening Mount Rushmore. The minister at my old church, who always looked the smallest children directly in the eye. The head football coach at Westchester University, who, beyond all reason, allowed a lowly student assistant to break down film. And my wife, who never tires of follow-up questions. Without prompting, colleagues often share moments when they were not listened to and how it made them feel. Ignored, unimportant, unsafe. It stands to reason, then, that we should create a culture of listening, an act that can be broken into discrete, practicable, and measurable skills. This is the first of many times in this book when I'll offer an approach that is by no means a panacea. Teachers, as some of the most creative people on earth, can create listening activities that fit their own style and pedagogical vision. I share only what has worked for me, hoping simply to shift the safe space conversation from the realm of magical thinking to a more practical, skills-based approach. Before I do so, however, there is one key understanding. Students and teachers might spend their entire lives learning how to listen. It is one of our hardest self-improvement missions and can be the most costly. Ask family and relationship counselors. We must understand this and orient our approach to student discipline accordingly. Students learning how to listen to one another might show the same symptoms of those who are being bad. But when we manage both issues equally, we scuttle students' opportunities to develop key listening skills. We can no more punish our way into a conversational safe space than we can conjure one from thin air. So we must instruct where we used to admonish, encourage where we used to excoriate, and carefully track what we used to ignore. In my classroom, the conversational safe space is established with three discussion guidelines: listen patiently, listen actively, and police your voice. After their introduction, each is practiced explicitly over the first few weeks, a period of time that I like to think of as a conversational training camp. This camp works as an extended norming that I reference for the rest of the year. Listen patiently. The more we care about a topic of conversation, the more we rush to speak. The less we care, the less we feel obligated to pay attention to conversational partners who do. In both instances, we often fail to show others that we are listening patiently to them. This display is important, as people cannot access your brain to measure your level of focus. Social cues are necessary to show people they have our attention. Practicing this skill requires a shift. Normally, after a teacher calls on a student to speak, we give most of our attention to the respondent. We shift our attention away only when someone else calls out or behaves in some way that we deem disrespectful. But to help students listen patiently, we must invest considerable focus on the students who are not speaking. And in doing so, offer some rules. First, hands should not be raised while someone is still talking. When a teacher calls on one student to speak, the rest of the hands in the room have to go down. Any student who does otherwise is communicating to everyone in the room that they don't care about the person who is still talking. That raised, and sometimes waving, arm is saying, "I wish you would shut up. I have my own thing to say." This behavior sparks an unnecessary rush for respondents, causing them to speak as if trying to squeeze comments in under the wire before their teacher dumps them for the other raised hands. Second, listening patiently means that students should never be interrupted. This is not new. Many teachers have variations of one voice at a time. The problem is that too many of us frame the rule as more disciplinary necessity than skill development. Students who have an impulse to interrupt each other care deeply about what is being discussed. This is a win. Calling out signals impatience, not meanness. Something in the student's brain is boiling and the lid couldn't hold it. But students must be taught that, one, their big eureka might be influenced by what is currently being said, and, two, patient listening is transactional, and when they speak, they will want their classmates to keep the lid on, too. This is more difficult when students come from environments that define safety as students are quiet. Dialogic classrooms offer so much new stimuli that it's easy to get wired. Also, students might not trust that they'll ever get a turn, so they try to squeeze their points in before the teacher shuts down the conversation. We don't interrupt for any reason, including affirmations and agreements, both of which still have the unintended effect of drawing focus from the speaker. Beyond these non-negotiable rules, there are countless suggestions. Try for eye contact. Try nodding. Try smiling. Try pursing your lips in thought. Students should reflect on what they appreciate from a listener and try to mimic those behaviors when someone else is speaking. Regardless of whether or not they are in doubt, they should ask each other if they feel listened to. Over the first few days of school, and often afterward, I offer various scenarios to illustrate the importance of listening patiently. One student raises his hand, and I ask others to wave theirs while she speaks. How does that make you feel? As a student speaks, I constantly interrupt him with seeming affirmations. Uh-huh, yeah, uh-huh, yes, I know, right? How does that make you feel? A student pauses to gather her thoughts, and I step in with, oh, that reminds me of. How does that make you feel? Throughout these scenarios, I pepper personal stories. For instance, as a stutterer, I've always hated interruptions, especially the last sort, where people would step in to help me finish, but would instead fling my conversation far from the thread I was trying to follow. I was going to get there, I tell students, if you would have just let me finish. A commitment to the language of listening patiently drastically impacts not just students' peer-to-peer interaction, but our core relationship with students. Consider the following classroom scenarios. Scenario A. Mike, interrupting Joe, a classmate. Yo, that same thing happened to me yesterday when... Mr. K, frustrated. One voice. You've got to stop interrupting. Mike, equally frustrated, whispering to a classmate, told you Mr. K doesn't like me. Scenario B. Mike, interrupting Joe, a classmate. Yo, that same thing happened to me yesterday when... Mr. K, smiling, holding up a placating hand. Patience, man. Listen to Joe. He's making a good point. Tell your story in a bit. Mike. Oh, my bad, Joe. In the second scenario, Mike's enthusiasm has survived the exchange. The teacher's choice to not be adversarial means that we might actually get to hear Mike's story, as he won't be too resentful to share it. Also, notice how in the second example, Mike is more likely to acknowledge Joe, whom he may have unintentionally annoyed with his zeal. Both students are likely to leave this exchange feeling listened to. Listen actively. Let's continue from the second classroom example in the previous section. Mike, in this moment, has just been reminded to listen patiently to his classmates. He may be tempted to ask, why? The answer is too often, to be respectful, or because calling out is bad. The ideal answer should be, Joe's ideas are worthwhile to everyone in the classroom community. Each idea can inspire another, can inform, can be the reason that no two classroom conversations are exactly the same. As such, ideas should not just be shared, but built on. In order to build, ideas must be actively collected before they dissipate. Toward this end, we must design structures that require students to engage each other's ideas and listen actively. In my class, this means notebooks where students are encouraged to write down classmates' comments that intrigue them. Student teachers, or occasionally student volunteers, do the same on the whiteboard. My student volunteer cited her classmates' contributions about Chapter 9 of Lord of the Flies by putting names next to each comment. Students eventually are encouraged to cite each other in essays as reliable sources, as fellow experts, when such citations are appropriate. As teachers, we can offer just as much praise to students who thoughtfully build on classmates' ideas as we offer to those who say cool things. In the early days of a school year, I like to follow the thread of a conversation, maybe even illustrated on the board. Joe said, blank, which inspired Mike to tell this story, which Marcia thought related to this character in the play. After she made this connection, Tanya told us about this book she read that seems to back up Joe's thesis. I love the way you all are building. After a few examples of this, students find themselves eager to cite each other. I teach them transitional language, my favorite being a simple, building on classmates' names, point. By middle of the year, I can tell how well my students are listening actively by how often the comments appear daisy-chained together by citation. Of course, I must also model appreciation for the original speaker, working hard to extrapolate points they might not be clearly articulating. This type of synthesis and modeling does require a lot of mental energy from the teacher, but it's work that transfers in a fairly short time. Consider the following scene, which demonstrates one student's comment with two teacher responses. Joe, recovering from Mike's interruption. Yeah, I was saying that when Troy uses the N-word in fences, it's different from when white people use it. Well, it's the same sometimes when he's yelling at his son. He wants to make him feel bad, like white people do when they say it sometimes. But when he's talking to Bono, because that's his best friend, the N-word is saying something else. It's saying, we are real tight, you know? Response A. Mr. K turns to the next raised hand. Good point. Response B. Mr. K, pausing reflectively to show patience. That makes sense. So people use the N-word for different reasons. But you're telling me that it can actually make people feel a sense of intimacy with their friends? That's interesting. Turning to his classmates. Joe says that the N-word can make people feel close to each other. Has anyone else seen this? This redirection, when properly executed, makes listening actively contagious. The trick is to never stop redirecting and to ceaselessly praise students for citing each other. Great discussions become self-rejuvenating creatures, truly student-centered events that rarely repeat themselves, even when the text being discussed is the same year after year. In addition, students don't feel just safe, but also important and smart. This makes it more likely that they will speak again. Police your voice. The focus shifts here, but still places listening at the forefront. If your classmates have to listen both patiently and actively to you, you must make it easier for them to do so by policing your voice. The teacher is no longer the prime audience, a fact that I make clear to students by pointing to their classmates and saying, "Speak to them." Early on in the school year, I constantly nudge my students to turn their faces away from me when answering a question, looking instead at peers. The reminder is gentle and often excited, as if I'm trying to say, what you're saying is too good for just me to hear. Let's get everyone else in on this stuff. Classmates are often surprised to have a speaker address comments to the larger group. Many perk up immediately because they are used to one-on-one student-teacher exchanges that they'd felt free to check out of. This encourages the golden moment when a student, without teacher prompting, asks classmates for their opinions on an issue. Whenever I hear this, I know they are nearly ready to keep each other safe during meaningful race conversations. The second part of policing your voice is understanding that students and teachers should speak succinctly. This means that, as a speaker, you are humbly aware of how much space you're taking up at any given moment. Class time is limited. Students should not speak forever. They should not repeat themselves or deliver sermonettes. Transgressions happen. Our students are young, impulsive, and we hope, impassioned. But there are ways to redirect that build community and respect instead of just shutting kids down. consider the two following scenarios. Scenario A. Maria, that reminds me of when... A two-minute, quasi-related story follows. Mr. K, visibly annoyed, cutting the student off at the first opportunity. Yes, but we're talking about... And please let other people talk. Maria, equally annoyed, whispering to a classmate, he's always cutting me off. Scenario B. Maria, that reminds me of when... A two-minute, quasi-related story follows. Mr. K. That's a great point. I didn't even see it like that before. Quick thing, let's remember to police our voices, right? Maria, sheepishly. Oh, my bad, y'all. As with the previous situations, option B removes multiple layers of unnecessary disciplinary tension. A teacher now has the language to say, I appreciate that you care enough to speak passionately in my class. Thank you for being awake. However, I need you to realize that other people are also awake, and they deserve the opportunity to speak as well. This particular interaction, however, requires an extra step. It helps to pull Maria aside after class to introduce her to, or remind her of, strategies for being succinct. She could consider pausing before she speaks to gather her thoughts so that she gets right to the important parts. She could work with me to build a reliable structure for her comments, like the one that career coach Leah McLeod published in her article, Three Smart Ways to Keep Yourself from Rambling, called PRES. First, state your point, the main idea, then your reason, why you think so, then an example, the evidence that backs you up, then offer summary, restate your main idea. There are many strategies out there. After this initial conversation, it's important to follow up with Maria, praising small successes with whatever strategy she's decided to try. A final, important note, we should acknowledge that a student who seems to ramble or have trouble following a conversational thread may have social anxiety or another learning difficulty. If you notice this happening frequently, be sure to bring in the rest of the student's support team just to double-check that the student is getting the needed supports. Practice listening. Patient listening, active listening, and policing your voice establish a good conversational foundation for the heavy stuff. But introducing the skills isn't enough. They must be framed and practiced. For me, there is the aforementioned training camp period. During the first few weeks of class, my students hold many practice conversations in both large and small group settings, after which we reflect, not on the topic, but on how well we listened to each other. Over the year, we openly try to climb from level to level in each skill. For example, listen patiently. Beginner. Students no longer interrupt each other, raise their hands, talk while others are talking. Advanced. Students exhibit good nonverbal, I am listening thoughtfully to you, behaviors. Listen actively. Beginner. Students reference each other's comments in their own. Advanced. Students follow up that reference with a high-order question to their classmates that pushes the conversation forward. Police your voice. Beginner. Students don't ramble on or stray far off topic when called on. Advanced. Students apply public speaking techniques of projection, articulation, etc. when speaking in class. They follow up by asking classmates if they were clear. And just as our students need to practice, so do we. Over our careers, many of us have developed instinctive overreactions to students' listening mistakes. Not to mention how often we find ourselves lacking the same listening skills we're trying to teach. How patient are we? My biggest problem is an instinct to interrupt students. It comes from a good place. I am eager to encourage. But that doesn't matter. I also have trouble policing my voice, especially when the subject is something I know more about than my students. The best and worst thing about practicing these skills with students is that they have the language to call me on my own mistakes. Yet their doing so is evidence that I'm that much closer to my ultimate goal, safety. My students know that their ideas are the sacred currency of our classroom, and that they will be received with a purposeful and structured empathy. Only from here can we move to meaningful conversations about race. House talk. Students might not be as afraid to discuss race as we often make them out to be, but this does not mean that they are eager to do so with us. Consider the following. I run an after-school poetry club. The first few minutes of every meeting are normally set aside for unstructured conversation because it gives exhausted students a chance to unwind after a long school day and to build community with each other. I sit with them, but generally keep my mouth shut, unless I'm directly asked to participate. In the fall of 2014, one of these conversations took an intriguing turn. One student had just left a class where they'd discussed that summer's protests in Ferguson, Missouri, which flared after the fatal shooting of Michael Brown, a young black man, by a white police officer, Darren Wilson. Apparently, one of her classmates had made a statement about the protesters that she'd found inappropriate. She became frustrated when her teacher didn't step in, and she aired these grievances in poetry club. Her fellow poets shared similar stories, some dating back to middle school. Over the next few minutes, two camps formed. Students annoyed about having to discuss the protests in a diverse environment, especially in conversations facilitated by white teachers, and students of all colors who were frustrated by the lack of Ferguson conversations in their classes. I pointed out the obvious conundrum. I asked our young poets, "What's a white teacher to do?" According to these students, white teachers were supposed to avoid discussing the Ferguson protests with students of color, an act that opened them to harsh criticism from the same minority students they were trying not to offend. A poet in the latter camp shrugged, then explained that the protests were monopolizing their social media, which made images from Ferguson constantly top of mind. Their school subjects seemed trite by comparison, and they appreciated that their teachers wanted to directly address the elephant in the room. A poet in the former camp offered a quick rebuttal to this cliche. "I don't want to talk about Ferguson with white people. No matter how liberal they are, it's still going to be just academic for them. But it's our actual lives. We really have to be black when this stuff is going on. I don't have the energy to explain my emotions every time a teacher decides to talk about race." There was near universal agreement, and the implications of her comment were not lost on me. Listening, as emphasized in the last section, is already hard. But it takes even more effort to both listen and to be heard when your conversational partners or facilitators don't have the same emotional sensitivities, investment, or cultural background. This exertion tempts minorities to just keep their mouths shut rather than enter into exchanges that would otherwise sap their energy. This debate, I told them, made me think of something. When I was growing up, my parents used the term house talk to label conversations that I was not to share with anyone else. This term implied that people outside of our family wouldn't understand, and involving them would annoyingly complicate things or cause actual trouble. I asked this latter group of student poets if they felt that race conversations were better kept as house talk. When they agreed, I asked them to explain. Interestingly, a white poet spoke first, sharing that during such conversations, she was often wary of offending classmates of color, not because she disagreed with them, but because she wasn't always as articulate as she wanted to be. There seemed to be 1,000 ways to be misinterpreted. Ask a question the wrong way and one might be chastised for one's ignorance. Disagree with a minor point, and one might be charged with leveling microaggressions. Occasionally, it seemed that her expected job was only to absorb the anger and frustrations of her classmates. One of their fellow poets, a black boy, answered this by sharing how he felt the need to soften such anger as to not offend well-meaning white classmates or teachers. After prodding, he admitted that he also was inclined to disguise his strong disinterest in the empathetic anger of white allies and pretend that it just doesn't frustrate him. At this, some admitted that, when tensions are highest, as they'd been during the height of the summer's protests, it's sometimes hard to look a white person in the face, even when that person is smiling. This last bit was rough to hear, a brutal honesty that was followed by silence. As I figured out where to go next, a few parallels came to mind. First, I considered classroom conversations about street harassment. By the time many of my female students reached ninth grade, too many of them have been repeatedly called the foulest words in the ugliest manner possible by complete strangers. In my role as mentor, I rail against this and do my best to affirm my female students when I can. However, I am not a woman, and as such, I recognize that I might look and sound like the man who tried to touch them this morning on the way to school. It would be hubris for me to expect every girl to feel comfortable sharing their anger, embarrassment, or shame with me. What is academic to me is visceral to them. At certain times, some would rather discuss their frustrations with a woman, who might better understand the violence of being objectified, the fear of late nights and lonely street corners. It's equally understandable if these girls don't want to deal with the annoyance of reassuring male classmates who might answer, "not all men," to their protestations. As the seconds ticked away, I thought about how often I had mishandled race conversations that I couldn't viscerally identify with. A few years earlier, I had been teaching Marcus Suzak's The Book Thief. For this unit, I'd wanted students to engage the countless propaganda tools used by Nazis during the Holocaust. Early in the text, the protagonist has to attend the BDM, the Hitler Youth for Girls, which inspired me to find out how adults tailored their propaganda to influence young girls. If I found primary sources, my students could then analyze their use of propaganda techniques. A quick Google search turned up a collection of anti-Semitic children's fables called Der Giftpilz, which begins with a famous story called The Poisonous Mushroom. In the tale, Jewish citizens are compared to mushrooms that appear harmless, but are capable of killing little boys and girls who can't distinguish them from less evil vegetables. I ordered it. For a teacher who had just spent a unit having students analyze and create allegories, it was a gold mine. 18 illustrated stories laying out the structure and intentions of anti-Semitism. When I showed it to my students, I haphazardly voiced my history nerd enthusiasm. My exact words may have been, "This is a beautiful thing." The kids giggled, all but one, Adam, who raised his hand to say, "Beautiful?" His great-grandparents, he told me, had escaped the Holocaust. I apologized immediately, though the import of my recklessness came at me in waves. How could I even make this mistake? I organize trips to the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. every year, and I have invited survivors to talk to my classes. I make certain to frame our Holocaust studies around resistance so as to not make the genocide just about victimhood. Every step of the unit planning is thoughtful, meant to respect the varied humanity of everyone who experienced the era's trauma. Yet I was still capable of such a terrific blunder, one that I would be considerably less likely to make if I were Jewish, and not merely a well-meaning black ally. In tough times, minority communities often believe that we're all we've got, so we more thoroughly invest in each other's well-being. Our struggles directly, and maybe even subconsciously, influence the language we use with each other. This became mortifyingly clear during the more publicized police shootings, as I noticed black students, leaving each other with a handshake and a reminder to stay safe. With this in mind, it should be easy to understand why minority students might prefer to discuss racial issues only within an intimate community of shared experiences. However, daily cultural exchange with students from different races has duped many teachers into assuming an intimacy that does not exist. We reason that since students from different backgrounds are comfortable discussing occasional racial topics with us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.